Paul K will be residue field C. And so the idea is we want to think about, you know, we have some variety over R, this is how we're going to represent our degeneration. So the generic fiber, it's going to be some smooth variety, but then we may not be able to extend that to a variety which is smooth over R. But once you have resolution of singularities, you can at least make something where you get a model that's regular and where the special fiber has strict normal crossings. So I'm going to call that an SNC variety over R. And so then in that case, what we have is that the special fiber is something with a lot of components. And so we want to understand what the geometry of that fiber looks like compared to geometry of generic fiber. Okay, so the object we're interested in is a combinatorial object called the Boole complex. And this is just the intersection complex of the special fiber. So we have a bunch of divisors. Those give us points in the intersection complex and the Boole complex. And where they intersect, we put a one cell, and when a bunch of them intersect, for every component, we put an n cell. And I'll show some examples in a little bit. So, you know, you've seen these things before. So, for example, if you have a GHG curve, then if you, say, take a semi-stable model of that curve, then, you know, it could be more or less degenerate, so you could have just good reduction in the Boole complex is just a point. But the cases we're going to be interested in this talk are the ones where you're very far from having good reduction, where you have a lot of components that intersect in an interesting way. So the most complicated Boole complex you can get from a genus G curve is a genus G graph. So, and no matter what model of the curve you take, as long as it's some of the more crossings, then you know it's the topological type isn't going to change. Thing about the curve of genus G, that goes back a long way, but more recently, people in birational geometry have gotten interested in these kind of questions and have been using techniques from the minimal model program to attack them. And so, in that case, so there's work of Ferdinand Kohler and Shu, who basically studied how these Boole complexes change under operations that you carry out in the model program. So things like divisorial contractions, and flips and flops. And they gave some conditions under which the Boole complex either doesn't change at all or changes in a controllable way, as in it changes via some kind of deformation retract. So as a consequence, they were able to show that when X is rationally connected, so when you have a degeneration of rationally connected varieties, and you have this kind of SNC model, then the Boole complex of special fiber is always contractible. And then, you know, kind of the next case from there is something like Klaba Yao. And so what I wrote here, I probably need some more assumptions, but morally what this is supposed to say is that if you have a semi-stable degeneration of Klaba Yao that's maximally unipotent, I won't explain that what that means, but it's something about the monodromy, then the Boole complex is going to be n-dimensional and will be the quotient of a finite quotient of a cube homology sphere.
So is there an example for this other sphere?
Well, okay, this is a good question. It depends on what singularity conditions you have. So you can really get something, you know, depending on what your conditions are, you can get something like RP3. But that's, of course, a quotient of a sphere. We don't know any examples where it's not where the covering space is in a sphere, but the state of the art is just Q homology sphere. But I think someone has probably conjectured that it is a sphere, although I don't know who I should attribute that to. Okay, so the context in which I might wish to study this is via Berkovich spaces. So the idea is that our Boole complex before was just a combinatorial object, but I want to give it a little more structure. I don't want to say too much about Berkovich spaces, but the idea is that if X is my variety over K, then the idea is that the data for Xn, so this is the Berkovich space, so this is going to consist of Here's where I have a point, an evaluation. So this is a scheme theoretic point of x. So in other words, the point of x is a scheme. So that includes something like a generic point. And v is evaluation on, maybe this has to be like, so this is a point on x. And then v is evaluation on the residue field at this point, extending evaluation on k. Okay, so in a little bit we'll see examples of this. So I emphasize the fact that these are scheme theoretic points because the most interesting case to me is when I take here, I take the generic point of x. So if this point is the generic point, well, that gives us a subset of xn. So this subset is called by rational points. We'll just write the beer of x. And you know, a lot of the action happens here. So in particular, our dual complex is going to embed inside the Burbridge space, and it's actually going to land inside the birational points. Okay, so the example I want to consider is if I take the vanishing of this equation, so I have t times the Fermat curve plus the coordinate hyperplanes x, y, z. So this is a cubic equation over R, and over k, I get something which is a genus 1 curve, which is smooth. But over R, it's not smooth because I have some normal crossings happening in the special fiber. And in the special fiber, I just get the coordinate hyperplanes, and of course, their dual complex is a triangle. So now I want to think about, okay, how this changes under birational modification. Because I can, of course, do things like make blowups to get a new R model while keeping my model over k the same. So how does that work? Well, you can see these schematic pictures. So the idea is that what I have in the middle is, so I have my divisors x, y, and z. So I'll just, if I want these as divisors, I really think they're loci vanishing. And then, of course, the line x equals 0 and the line y equals 0 intersects at a single point, so you connect those up with an edge, connect these two up with an edge, and connect these up with an edge, but because they're projective, the projective plane, they don't all three intersect, so I leave the interior empty. So one blow up that I can do is that I can just blow up some point on this line that doesn't, that isn't any, either of the intersection points. So I just blow up, say the point 0, 1, 1, so this isn't any of the intersection points. And so what happens is that I get a new divisor jutting out here. Whereas if I just blow up, say, I guess here I blew up where y and z were 0, so if I blow up 1, 0, 0, well then, this modification is toroidal with respect to the structure of this divisor, this normal crossings divisor. So all I'm doing is I take a subdivision. And then this is like exceptional divisor E. And so now I guess it's not, I guess these are now strict transforms. So it's EZ transform, but this is still V of X. Okay, but the point is that the picture has changed because see here, with this blow up, the topology of the dual complex has changed. In that, so the homotopy type is the same, but I have an extra thing jutting off here. Whereas here, this is just a PL homeomorphism. So I want to understand what's the difference between these. And that difference is explained by the adjunction formula. So the idea is that, so let's say y is my blow-up and x is what I had downstairs. And so what I really want to do is I want to think of, instead of just the data of x, I want to think of x along with its reduced special fiber to think of that as a pair. And so there, instead of thinking about the canonical divisor, I think about the log canonical divisor. So the you know, the top degree forms with possibly poles along the components of the special fiber. And so there, I get this adjunction formula, which just says, well, if I take ky plus the reduced special fiber of y, that's the pullback of kx plus the reduced special fiber of x, plus some correction term, which is the log discrepancy. So this is a term in Bayesian geometry. And so the fact here is, because this is a nice S and C pair, this log discrepancy is always going to be non-negative. Okay, so if I extract the divisor by blowing up the intersection here, well, if we think about what's happening, if there's no boundary, if there's no pair, well, I know that ky is equal to f upper star of kx plus e. So when I add the y red in, I'm going to add a copy of e over here. And then when I add the x red in there, I'm going to subtract off the multiplicity of e in the special fiber on this side. So what happens is I get, so I'm adding one copy of e, and then if I blow up something that's at the intersection of these two, then I'm subtracting two copies, which gives me a equals zero. On the other hand, if I'm just on one divisor, as in this case, then I'm adding a copy over here, so I get a plus one and a minus one, and I'm just left with a equals one. So when I make a blow up with a equals one, I change the dual complex. I change the PL homeomorphism type, although it's still the same homotopy type. Whereas on this side, when I extract something in log discrepancy a equals zero, then I've given you a PL homeomorphism. Okay, so. So what people have done is they've taken this idea and kind of, you know, just try to make it as simple as possible in Berkowitz geometry. And so what they do is they say, okay, you know, let's forget about running a minimal model program, let's forget about models, but just remember the log discrepancies. And so the amazing thing is that you can just compute these things, I mean, in this case they're called weight functions, and without having to, you know, deal with vanishing theorems and all this other stuff, you can just take some SNC model, compute your wave function there, and it'll be the same everywhere. So the idea is that you have this function called a wave function, and you assign one to every pluricanonical form. And you know, you want some conditions on your pluricanonical form. Traditionally, you know, you can define a wave function for any pluricanonical form, but the ones that are going to be interesting are the either the regular ones or the log regular ones. So you need some condition on the pluricanonical form to get that this weight function has a minimum. And the idea is that the place where the weight function has the minimum is exactly the valuations where you have log discrepancy zero, aka the log canonical centers. So so the first place this shows up is in Murkoff and Savitch and Soglin, where what they want to do is they want to do mirror symmetry for K3 surfaces. And so then the idea is that, so in that case, well, this is a Calabi-Yau, it's degenerating, and so we expect the special fiber to look like a sphere, and in that case, the K3 surfaces really do get an S2. And so the idea is this is supposed to be the base of the SYZ fibration. So what they wanted to do is they wanted to establish some way of seeing that sphere independently of a choice of model. So what they did is they defined this weight function, and so now, when you have a K3 surface, you're plowing out this regularity condition, well, there's only one, you know, there's sort of one regular pluricanonical form in every degree, which is the trivial one. So you just have to check that one trivial form, and its minimality locus is exactly that sphere. And so then the sum in a case noticed this, and noticed that you could do this in much larger generality. And in fact, so this isn't on the slide, but one thing that we did is that we extended their definition when you lose regular here and take instead log regular. And so this gives us a broader definition of the skeleton. So again, the nice thing about this is that it doesn't depend on the choice of our model, and it's also a birational invariant of x, which is the variety over, this should be xk, let's say, variety over k. So And also, so you might want to say, okay, well, is this the dual complex of anything? And in fact, if you have the minimal model program, Nikesh and Chu showed that if you have a good DLT minimal R model, then this essential skeleton is that can be identified with that dual complex. Okay, so now let's talk about the main theorem. So our main theorem says it is trying to understand what happens to this essential skeleton when you take the product of degenerations. I mean, that's why I called the talk that. So the idea is that we start with these two varieties, x and y, and we want them to have, you know, some singular tradition over the generic fiber, let's just say smooth. But we also want to force them to have semi-stable SNC R models. So it turns out this semi-stable condition is actually very important. But in that case, we're allowed to conclude that if you take the product over K and take the skeleton, then that's the product of the skeleton, as you might expect. And in fact, since we can think of these as valuations, well, it's very easy to get some natural maps from valuations on the product to valuations on X and valuations on Y and just restrict to the functions that came from X or Y. And that indeed gives you the projection on the two factors. So, I mean, you can kind of think of that as a sort of functional reality statement. All right, so a couple of comments about this. So one is that the semi-stable condition, you really need it, because if you don't have it, then the theorem is no longer true. What happens instead is that you get something where, instead of having an isomorphism, you have a local isomorphism, so you have, you have at least kind of set theoretically a local isomorphism, so you get something that's finite to one. There could be some branching. So the other thing is that, I mean, one of the technical difficulties in proving this theorem is, you might say, okay, well, what we want to do is we take an R model for X and an R model for Y, and then we take the product. Well, the problem is that if you take that product, it's no longer S and C. So you introduce some singularities, and at first this is problematic, but the point is that you're never producing singularities that are too bad. So what happens? So one thing you might have is that you might have the product, let's say, of just in the simplest case. Where X has an R model like this, so this is the special fiber, and then Y just looks the same. So I have some curve degenerated in two curves in both cases. So this is X, Y, R, and Y, R. And so then if I take the product of R, so what that looks like is I have some surface. So over the generic fiber, it's fine. But then in the special fiber, I get I get divisors corresponding to pairs of divisors over here. So I get four divisors, and they intersect like this. And so if I take this divisor here, which is like this one and this one, and this divisor here, which is like this one, and I take their intersection, I get a point. Whereas the intersection of two divisors in a threefold should give me something which is a curve. And so what's going on here is that these divisors are not Q Cartier. And in fact, you know, you can make a model for this where you're actually getting here the affine quadrant threefold. And so, I mean, this seems bad, but because this is an SNC and it's not even Q factorial, but what it is that it's toroidal. And so we can use the theory of toroidal varieties. In fact, what we use instead is theory of Kadofans, which generalizes that, to allow this as a good model and define a skeleton for this. So that's what goes into proving this. Okay. And so now we have a corollary, which actually is not quite correct. It doesn't quite follow from what I wrote on the board, but there's more of a theorem in the paper. But this just says that if we take a smooth surface, and then we take the n-symmetric power of x. So we just take n copies of x, and then quotient out by the symmetric action. Then the skeleton of that is the n-symmetric power of the skeleton of x. Okay, so a couple of comments is that this is birational to the Hilbert scheme. So if I take it, in fact, it has a Cochrane resolution, which is the Hilbert scheme of X. And so, and the essential skeleton doesn't depend on the choice of model for X. So this says that the skeleton of the Hilbert scheme is the nth symmetric power of the skeleton of X. So the other comment here is that this is not true for curves anymore, because this action has fixed points in codimension 2, whereas for a curve it'll have fixed points in codimension 1, which means a ramification, and so that throws off your calculation to be able to compare differentials on both sides. Okay, so I think I have a little less than 10 minutes left, and that's enough time to do the fun part, which is the application to generations of hyperkaler varieties. Okay, so hyperkaler variety is kind of a higher dimensional generalization of K3 surface. It's a smooth projective variety that has a global non-generator 2 form. This should also say simply connected, but I forgot to put it down, but simply connected. So, you know, it's a very beautiful theory. I mean, in particular, there's the Bogomolov decomposition theorem, which says that these are one of the fundamental building blocks of K-trivial varieties. Okay, so this should be the resolution of SimN, but you know, if you take tilde, then that's there. So if you take the Hilbert scheme of endpoints in a K3 surface, which is a Cochrane resolution of SimN of S, there's also the generalized Hummer variety. So the idea here is that, again, this should be the Hilbert scheme. So you take the Hilbert scheme of n plus 1 points on A, which is an abelian surface, and then so inside here, you can take the locus of points. There's a multiplication law coming from the fact that these are endpoints on the abelian surface, and then you can take the locus of points that multiply and give you zero. And so that's some codimension 2 locus, and so this has dimension 2n, and you can check this is actually a smooth projective, you know, if the abelian surface is projective, and this is projective, and it's hyperkaler. And aside from two more examples of dimension 6 and 10, which are due to a gradient, these are the only examples up to deformation. So of course there are other examples of hyperkalers known. I mean, so there's, you know, this example due to work due to Vino Donaghi about the Fano variety lines in the cubic fourfold is a hyperkaler variety, but it belongs to, I think it's this family for some n. Okay, so the key here is that we're looking at Hilbert schemes in both cases. I mean, pretend these are as the resolution there. And so in both cases, we can apply our theorem and compare the essential skeleton or dual complex of a DLT minimal model of each of these examples with a K3 surface. Okay, so these are classified by types, so this is telling you about how nilpotent the monomer operator is. So in type 1, that's like the good reduction case, and so there the dual complex is a point, so we're going to skip that and so consider that uninteresting. And so for K3 surfaces, which is kind of our base case, you get a closed interval in type 2, and then you get the two-sphere in type 3. So, I mean, this is, goes back to Kulikov. And then for abelian surfaces, which is our other case for the Kummer construction, you get S1 in type 2 and S1 cross S1 in type 3. And I'm always thinking about semi-stable degenerations now. Okay, so. So there's been some recent work on this problem. So for a type 2 K3 surface, where the special fiber has two components, Gilbertson, Halle, Heck, Gulek, and Zhang actually constructed a model for the Hilbert scheme using GIT. So they actually made a moduli problem that extended over R, and they found that the dual complex was an n-simplex. So for using very different techniques, so Kolar, Laza, Sakan, Bozen, showed that in type 2, the dual complex of the minimal DLT model has dimension n. I think they probably also showed that it has trivial Kuh cohomology, but I didn't see it in the paper when I was writing up these notes, but I think they, I mean, certainly follows from their techniques. And I'm sure it's in the paper somewhere. And then in type 3, they showed that the dimension is 2n and the cube cohomology is that of CPN. And so CPN is actually pretty significant here because, so I believe it's known due to work, I think, with Wang, that if you have a holomorphic fibration of a hyperkähler manifold over something of complex of dimension n, that base has to be CPN. And then the dual complex in mirror symmetry, we expect that to be the dual, look like the base of a fibration. That's the, kind of how it works in the S by Z conjecture. So it would make sense for, in the type 3 case, the dual complex to actually be an honest CPN. Okay, so let's see what we got. So in the Hilbert case, then if we just have the skeleton of the Hilbert scheme, or also the skeleton of the symmetric nth power is the symmetric nth power of the skeleton. So in type 2, you take the skeleton of an interval and you get, well, a simplex, but we're only doing this to PL, so we're just saying n disk. And in type 3, you're taking the nth symmetric power of an S2. Well, you know, algebraically, that could be the nth symmetric power of a P1, which gives you CPN. We get CPN. Okay, so now we do the Kummer case. And so this one's a little bit trickier, but it's still handleable by stuff that's been done before. So the main thing to worry about is what the multiplication map does. And so you can just work out that the multiplication map is exactly what you think it is, that it's just the skeleton gets the obvious group structure of some kind of torus. So in type 1, you get the quotient s1 to the n mod the symmetric group on n plus 1 letters. And this is, in fact, the fundamental domain of the affine Weyl group, you know, acting on the usual space. And it's then simplex. You know, I can show you later if you like. And then in type 2, quotient is again CPN. So why is that? Well, the left side you can think of as the complete linear series of the divisor of degree n plus 1 on a complex curve genus 1. So this is your curve of genus 1. And then if you took the S1 squared is a complex curve of genus 1, if you took n plus 1 copies, modulo Sn plus 1, that's all the linear series. And then you lose one S1 by taking, you lose one S1 squared by taking the fiber over a single point. And if you take the complete linear series of the divisor of degree n plus 1 on an elliptic curve, you get a CPN. Okay, so in both cases, we get the same answers, which, you know, suggests this is what we should get in general. So that was all I wanted to say. Thank you.
Can you say something about the models associated to the cells of these skeletons?
Yeah, that's a good question. So we haven't, but in principle one could. So because when you take the product, I mean, you can just do all the bookkeeping, it's really the product. And then when you take the symmetric, and then when you quotient out, you're just, you know, it's the usual group action. The only problem is that if you want to do this for an actual, like, good model, a good DLT model, then you have to make some birational modifications at the end. Now, this should all be controlled by combinatorics because it's all toroidal, but it might be somewhat involved. But in principle, yes, you can get that information out of our machine. Yes?
If you take an abstract normal crossing variety, there are, as you know, sort of subtle chronological conditions that be smoothable.
Yes.
Triple point formula and so on. Can you rule out complexes as not being arising as a dual complex or something smoothable? And that's not a well-known problem because you have to allow birational stuff.
Right.
Do the simple one first.
So you mean a PL homeomorphism type of dual complex then?
Yeah, just take.
That's a good question, which I do not know the answer to. But yeah, I mean that would be a very interesting thing about it, just to say if you have like any abstract dual complex of some dimension, and let's K can you just find one that isn't smoothable at all? Because I guess for curves, they're all smoothable, right?
They're smoothable. For curves, it's easy.
Yeah. Yeah, I don't know. That's an interesting question.
For surfaces, it's basically the triple point formula.
Right. Yeah, I mean, I've talked to Andrew Harder a bit about kind of the other, the flip side of this, which is to say, okay, we'll just like write down a complex and then smooth it. And then, you know, you write down something at CPN and you make a hypercalor that way. And, you know, he's more optimistic about it than I am. But, I don't know the answer to that, though.
Yeah, well.